Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, February 21st. Everyone asking her to please rise for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. I will entertain a motion to approve the expense warrants for 2/21/17.
So moved.
I will second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
There is no announcements on the public on the agenda, but I'm going to take correspondence and make an announcement, so it's right first and foremost. The Tantasco Regional School Union 61 District is notifying the town that a public hearing on the proposed Brookfield Elementary School budget for 2017-2018 will be held Tuesday, March 14th, 2017 at 6:30 p.m. at the Brookfield Elementary School in accordance with Mass General Law Chapter 71, Section 38N. Copies of the proposed budget are available from the office of the principal at Brookfield Elementary School. The regular school committee meeting will begin at 6 p.m. Any other announcements? Hearing none. Anybody wish to address the board this evening?
I do.
Welcome, sir.
Worthy.
You're going to have to come up to the table, please.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Were the Board of Assessors involved with a property at 41 Rice Corner Road?
Involved with it?
Yeah.
I don't understand the question.
Did information they had involving 41 Rice Corner Road end up before the Board of Selectmen for some type of possession? The lady wanted to dispose of her property?
Yes.
Did the town of Brookfield invest money in researching the deed or the legal way to do this?
No.
We approved.
Excuse me?
We approved.
The answer is no.
The answer is yes.
The answer is no, Bruce.
Okay. You go talk to your accountant, okay? It's $332.50. That's what it is.
The Board of Selectmen never spent that. If
KP was paid.
If the money was spent, that was through the assessor's office. It wasn't through the Board of Selectmen.
I want to tell you something. Mr. Jones came in and told me that he didn't have the money to pay the bill for KP, that the Selectman's office paid it. And I told him yes, that we could.
And then you bought the property.
That was before.
Did I buy the property?
You did buy it.
I did buy the property.
So wait a minute now, hold it. The town was involved with somebody wanting to dispose of their property. The town invested money in a deed researcher, a title researcher, or... Don't shake your head no, Steve. We spent money on it.
It's not on my accord.
And then something that entered this town for the town to acquire, because that's what the intentions were, for the town to acquire this piece of property for another purpose. You turned around from the information that came across the selectman's desk and purchased that property personally.
I purchased the property personally.
From information that came across the selectman's desk, that's what led you to this.
From information on a piece of property that was on the open market.
That came before the Board of Selectmen.
It did come before the Board of Selectmen.
Steve, that's as unethical as you can believe.
I disagree.
$200 to purchase a 0.48 acre parcel under half an acre. $200 is what you paid. The town's value was $43,900 on the property. This is an elderly woman,
which
under duress.
Happens to be your aunt.
She lost her. She's not my aunt.
She's
a cousin. She's not my aunt.
She made the transaction.
Don't tell me what she is to me.
Don't tell me that I'm doing anything unethical.
You are.
If you want to have a civil discussion,
it's done.
We can have that.
It's done.
If you don't want to have a civil discussion, we're done now.
We spent public money on a private source is exactly what we did.
Is this a discussion towards me, or is it for everybody in the room and the camera?
Everybody in the room and the camera and the Board of Selectmen.
All right.
Public money for a private purpose. That's what happened here.
Not on my end. I did not approve any money to be spent on this property.
I'm going to tell you something honestly, Bruce. When Mr. Jones came and asked me, I didn't even realize I didn't know anything that was going on about Granger. He asked me, and I know sometimes if he doesn't have money, sometimes I know the board definitely has to pay for out of our budget for certain land.
Did you sign for it, Steve?
I didn't tell him. He didn't even know.
Oh, that'd be like the chief's police cruiser or the chief's the fire cruiser. Nobody knows if they signed for that either, right? But you did.
I signed for it.
It's paid.
It's paid.
So we did have a conversation.
In regards to what?
Crane.
And? So this seems like an attack on me. Obviously, you knew about this, and so go for it, Max.
He didn't know about it. He didn't know about it until I told him a week ago.
It was the worst kept secret in town. I knew this was coming for 2 weeks. I knew this was coming for 3 years ago when you assaulted me in that office and said that
she wasn't selling this property three years ago.
That payback is a bitch was your exact quote to me. Because the Board of Selectmen didn't put you on the building committee for the police.
You can say anything you want, Steve. You cannot deny what happened.
I'm not denying it.
Yeah.
I purchased the property. Yeah. I paid the back taxes that she did not pay. I paid all legal expenses that were messed up because you were involved in this. Your transfer to her back in the 70s when the title was done wrong, and I compensated her money. At an arm's length transaction.
Steve, rotten deal. It came through this town. It came through this town, through your office, and you purchased it.
It didn't come through this office. The discussion we had, everyone agreed the town was not in the business of obtaining property. It had to go before the townspeople in June. And I was to reach out to her. I reached out to Al Jones. He made the comment.
What happened? Didn't get there, did it?
Are you going to let me speak?
What for?
Then we're done with this. Anything else you'd like to address the board this evening, Bruce?
Yeah. Elderly woman, under duress, lost her husband over a battle with this piece of property.
I have a signed contract.
Right?
How is that under duress? Through an attorney.
Yeah.
Assigned purchase and sales. How is that under duress?
And Steve steps in and buys it after she walked into this town and seeking help to dispose of this piece of property,
which
came before the Board of Selectmen.
All right. Clarence?
Well, the only thing I will remark is that we did have a conversation about that.
I'm not denying it.
And that's the one
point. I have ethics. You can take a look at that. There's no
They'll take a look at it themselves. I called them already.
I'm sure you did. There's no violation in that. You can contact town council to see if there's any ethics violation. I let Clarence do that personally himself. Al Jones, there was disclosure with Al Jones. He was the actual individual that recommended that I purchase that property. My first response is, Al, is that ethical? Why isn't it, Steve?
Why would you ask him?
Because that was a knee-jerk reaction. Is it ethical?
Yeah. Too many knee-jerk reactions
on
your part.
Anybody else wish to address it this evening? Welcome, sir.
Welcome, everyone. Now, I can say one thing about this little deal here is when I bought the house down on Prouty Street, I didn't learn about it because I have no computers. I learned it out right here. If I wasn't involved in the town, I would have never known that house went for $100. So I took advantage of it. So I hope that doesn't make me look bad. Saved the town a lot of money, and I saved the house, and I made a few bucks. All right, with that being said, Clarence, we've been talking about these procedures and policies. I brought it up to the advisory board, and we went over it briefly. We did go over it.
Yep.
And they look pretty good, both of them. And you yourself even thought it was pretty well done afterwards. You criticized them. And first you criticized them, and then you said it was pretty good, right?
I think recently said it was pretty good.
Right, I mean, any good document can be tweaked.
Absolutely.
Now, if it's no more than a document here, at least it's a guideline, and it's more than a guideline here.
It's more than a guideline.
Right, and it's something that the town's employees have to go by, correct?
That's correct.
And then nobody went by it. In the situation that we're talking about.
I did not say that nobody went by it.
Well, the situation that we have before the town. It wasn't followed, even looked at. It just, the whole thing was completely brushed over. But you're putting a barrage out there. You're trying to confuse the waters of what actually took place here. And you criticized it and put it down, criticized it, said, eh. But yet, back a year and a half ago, you voted to have this implemented.
Absolutely, in my first meeting.
It doesn't matter. You implemented it, you put it in.
Yeah.
And then you turn around because it's a self-serving town employee got in trouble and you're trying to make a barrage saying that this document is not good enough. But yet you voted this in a year and a half ago.
I think we've all learned from the document. Document can be approved.
What did we learn?
Probably the largest thing in there is the 2011 procedure was not brought forward into that document.
Okay.
Which town council has ruled that that supersedes that document because of specific earmark to an account?
Yeah, well, then that was one of my questions as to how. Again, I don't have that rule. Did you get that rule?
She stated it to me.
Oh, all right.
So we're going to go forward and use this, correct? I mean, it seems to be a pretty decent...
We have been using it.
It seems to be a pretty decent document. But we got to start using it. Can't be just overlooked and just...
And I volunteered to chair a meeting next Tuesday, 10 a.m., where we're going to have department heads join in to a review of that document so that we can understand what if there are issues with the document. Otherwise, we're going to have the employees acknowledge that they have receipt of it and they're working to
Okay, I think any department head has seen this.
Oh, I'm sure they've seen it, but
many times.
But nobody acknowledged that they received it or that they were living to it.
Well, technicality, but
technicality or not, it's reality.
It may be reality, but I'm just saying that, you know, even if we do have this in place and no one follows it and everyone just...
What's the sense of having it?
I disagree. I think it's been followed. I think one or two outliers.
I think that's correct.
So and I think what this is leading to was a Telegram Gazette article from last week, which I was kind of, I don't want to use the word upset about, because it made it appear that everything discussed in that article was in the meeting. I'm assuming that you had a private conversation with outside. That article did not state that there was a private conversation with you. It made you look like you were speaking for the board.
Oh, and that's farthest from the truth.
And I know because I was there. But
I was there, and only half of that was discussed at the board. What was in the article?
I was in both, but that's fine.
So was that the point, Dave?
That was my point, so.
Right. Anything else?
No.
Thank you. Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Hearing nobody. We have an issue here, Clarence. Item number one.
Yep.
I just got thrown to the wolves. This poll hearing happens to be my poll hearing.
Oh, so how do you want to handle that?
That's up to you. I was going to recuse myself and let you and Linda vote on it, but Linda's not here, and so it's totally up to you. I don't think it's unethical. It's not on my land. It's up to the abutters. We're only here because
it's a
poll hearing.
So we're not making a vote.
We do have to take a vote to allow them to place Verizon to place the poll on town property.
Then I would say, since someone's here from Verizon, then we afford them the opportunity. But then I think, again, because there is some connection, I would recommend that the vote be held next Tuesday if that's what we're going to need.
I don't think that can happen. So can you come on up and
let's figure out what.
So first question, is there anybody here for the poll hearing? There's nobody here for the poll hearing? You are here for the poll hearing?
We read in the Telegram it said that it was regarding Hidden Out and all the water drainage and the people fixing that.
This is on the other side of town altogether? This is on Wells Road, which is on the Sturbridge line near Tantasqua.
Well, in the Telegram, it said Hidden Kimball Street.
Oh, that's for the next hearing.
Yeah. They gave tonight's date.
It is. It is for tonight, but it's not this item. It's the next item. So it's not for the poll hearing. It's for something else. So is anybody here for the poll hearing? Can you explain, if we have the discussion tonight, that I recuse myself, can we vote on it in 2 weeks, or do you have to be here?
Yeah, I'm from National Grid, by the way.
Oh,
I just want to clarify. No worries. So if you recuse yourself, then we just redo this. And I would have to, so me or somebody else would have to come back out to be present for the vote and for the hearing.
Can that be done in 2 weeks?
It can be done whenever you guys decide. You just notify us.
I thought they paid for it.
Verizon pays for it. National Grid costs us like $40.
It costs $40?
To mail up all the
other things. So, okay, so I think we move forward with this intuition.
I'm having a hard time here because I did not know that Al spent money for that property.
It's
to the point that I'm about to write a check for that. I paid all the other legal expenses. I had no idea it was there. I'm a cheap guy, and 40 bucks is 40 bucks. But I don't want to get dragged on a carpet.
Okay.
I bust my butt for this town.
Okay.
I volunteer friggin' I spent weeks on that roof next door. Spent weeks down at the friggin' dugout. So.
Yeah.
Thanks.
I'm not 100% sure the entire process when it comes down to the financials, because I'm just the engineer for the job. So I don't think it'd be wise of me to respond in that matter.
Yeah.
But it's someone from National Grid, myself, probably.
Well, with a complaint against me out there already, I don't want to have another one. So we'll reschedule it.
Okay.
And we'll put it on for the next agenda in 2 weeks.
Okay, I'll let my office know in the morning, and then we'll just touch base.
I apologize.
No worries. Yeah.
All right, thank you, sir.
No problem.
Item number two, it being 6:15 p.m., I will entertain a motion to enter a public hearing for the fiscal year 2017 CDBG application. Do I have a motion? Do I have a second? I have a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
All right, my name is Andrew Lowe. I'm from the Central Massachusetts Regional Planning Commission, which is the public planning agency for the city of Worcester and 39 other towns in Worcester County. Excuse me. Tonight, I'm here to present and, if desired, discuss the town's proposed FY 2017 Community Development Block Grant application and to request that the Board of Selectmen vote to authorize submission of the application by CMRPC on the town's behalf. So a little background on the projects, on the grant program. Community Development Block Grant is a federal grant program from the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. Projects primarily have to serve low to moderate income beneficiaries or eliminate what they used to call blight. It's administered for communities below around 50,000 population by the Mass Department of Housing and Community Development. In this fiscal year, towns are limited to seeking up to $800,000. Or receiving up to $1.35 million over a two-year period. So this is a competitive grant program. There's no guarantee that any part of it will be funded. If it's awarded, the grant would be for an 18-month period. So working with some local folks in town officials, which I'll touch on a little bit later, we've developed four projects for this year's application. And I should say, by the way, for folks in the audience, there is a handout here that I'm referring to, so if you'd like to come up and take one.
Yes.
Please do. So the four projects are the one that a member of the audience referred to a moment ago, starting with that. An engineering design project in the Hayden and Hyde area, as well as the Draper and High Streets area. That would be to design drainage as well as some water infrastructure improvements. So again, that's just for engineering design at this point. Future funds would be needed to build the improvements. And that's to help address some recurrent flooding and some other issues in those areas. The next project is an Americans with Disabilities Act self-evaluation and transition plan. So this is something that's actually been on the books since 1990, that all municipalities are supposed to have these. It's an evaluation of town buildings, procedures, and policies with regard to handicapped access, including a development of a plan to help implement improvements for access. The next project is a senior center architectural design project. So that would be for architectural design for later construction of a senior center to serve Brookfield's aging senior population. The fourth project would be an environmental study for the 15 Post Road property. That's a former gas station site that's had a good amount of environmental analysis done before, but it does need more sampling and analysis and planning, cleanup planning, until to make it so that it could be cleaned up and redeveloped.
Would that be a full phase three?
Yes, that would go right through phase three cleanup plan. It can't get into the actual bid documents. It's just, it's right through the cleanup plan itself, not the bid docs. It's the nature of this funding. It's considered a planning project for CDBG, so that means you can't have full-blown plans and specs, unfortunately. That would have to be a subsequent step. And then grant administration is part of this project. I should say right now that the budget that's on the handout and that went to the selectmen earlier, I hadn't received the formal cost estimate for the senior center design project at that point. I just received it yesterday. It's somewhat higher than you see here, so the ballpark budget for that had been about $63,000. It's going to be about $100,000. So the total grant application, which is listed here at a little over $320,000, will be about $360,000, reflecting that the change to the design project. So the project selection process, these four projects have been, some of them on the town's radar for a number of years, is my understanding. There is a community development block grant advisory committee. The chair and a number of members are here tonight. Bruce Clark is the chair. You know how we got here tonight with these four projects. There was a community development strategy forum here at the selectmen's meeting on December 13. There was a public survey regarding the senior center project. It was distributed as hard copy as well as on the town's website. There was a public forum regarding the senior center planning at the Council on Aging last week. There was a survey that went out to residents in the Hayden and Hyde and Draper and High areas about their water and drainage issues, which the town has been aware of for a number of years, but we wanted to confirm that it's still a problem. There were social media and website posts. There was some media coverage, and we are here tonight at the advertised public hearing. Timing-wise, the application is due on March the 10th. With the federal administration change, we're not quite sure what the timing of the award would be, but we expect it'll probably be July, maybe a little later. So that's the summary of the application, and I do propose or recommend that the board consider the following language for a motion, which would be to support and approve the submission of the FY17 CDBG application, including the activities as presented today, with allowance for minor budget or program adjustments, and furthermore, to authorize the chair and the CFO to sign documents required for the application. I'm happy to answer any questions.
So with the addition of the cost for the senior project, does that put us out of contention? Or?
Absolutely not. You can apply for up to $800,000, so you're still well within the limits.
Yeah. So that actually looks good still.
I think it does. If you apply for a grant that's too small, they sometimes wonder if it's efficient to do it that way. But I think it tactically does help the town a little bit because sometimes they like to fit in a smaller grant rather than award all maximum grants.
Two forms that we talked about at the last meeting was one, notifying the Office of Disabilities that we were in non-compliance. Does that put the town in any liability?
I don't believe so. So what you're referring to is that for this year's grant application, there's a new requirement that all towns either already have this ADA self-evaluation and transition plan that I discussed a little earlier, or that if you don't have it, you have to submit a form to the state saying, we recognize that we don't have it, and we will talk to the Mass Office on Disability about documenting a process so that we will develop this plan.
What liability does that put the town into?
My understanding, I've spoken to the director of the Mass Office on Disability, is that this is really just intended to make sure towns are aware that they don't have this plan and to get them in the pipeline for getting one of these plans down the road. It's not their intention to say, you need to have it a year from today.
Speaking with him a couple years ago, implementing money, just the fact that we have plans for the town hall puts us in a good advantage.
Yeah, actually, a lot of the content that's been developed for previous studies can go right into that transition plan. I think it's, you've definitely shown that you are aware of these issues, which I think can only help with any.
And this comes with grants to get that self-evaluation?
Yes, we are applying for that very plan as part of this application.
So we need to address it in order to move
forward. You can't apply without signing that form, unfortunately. It used to be that you only needed to have this plan if you wanted to do a project that addressed ADA issues, but starting this year, they're requiring that all towns just have it. Or if not, then at least
and we've been in contact back and forth in regards to the wording of the second document. And
yes.
Words do mean something. I like the way that it's worded this time. The way that it was worded was that there will be a senior center in the basement.
we can't do that because we don't have the money for it. This says it's proposed.
Yeah, it's contingent upon funding, yes.
Have you read these documents? Are you good with
them?
And the third one is the actual application for the joint application.
Yes, I should say for folks in the audience who aren't aware is that, so Brookfield is applying for this grant, but Brookfield, if so voted by the Selectmen, would also participate in a joint regional application led by the town of Sturbridge that would be oriented to housing rehabilitation programs for low to moderate income folks, as well as a program that's designed for seniors to make some improvements to their homes. That would actually be a grant program to seniors. So that's the second application in the form that you're referring to. It's the, I believe it's called the joint authorization form. That would make you a participant in Sturbridge's application.
Do you have any questions?
No.
Does anybody have any questions? Yes,
ma'am. What happens if you go forward and you get all these engineering designs and architectural designs? What happens if a particular project doesn't go forward after that's been done?
So you mean if you were to apply to design a project and get it, but then you aren't able to find funding to build it? Well, I mean, generally speaking, nothing happens. There is a clause in the grant application that if you design a project, you're supposed to try to build it within 5 years. I don't believe that the state, I know actually that the state has never once enforced anything on a community that has gone past that 5 year window. But it's in the grant application that.
And what's the matching part of the grant?
Okay, so that's actually new for this program. In the past there had, well, at least for 15 years or so, there had been no match requirement. There's still no match requirement, but there is an advantage in the grant scoring to have a match. So on a project by project basis, excluding the two planning projects, you don't need a match for those two. It's just for the engineering design and the senior center design. If you can match more than 10%, you get 2 points in your grant application. A smaller match is 1%, and no match, you lose 2 points. So the Water Commission has voted at a meeting last month to provide a 10% match for the engineering design project. So I thank them for their contribution using their own, the funding that they have access to. And the Friends of Brookfield Town Hall have also authorized, I believe, was it?
Up to 2,000
towards the senior center project here. Although, you know, as I mentioned, the estimate for the design project for the senior center has gone up to a degree that I don't believe the town will want to invest to achieve the 10% or greater match. It's a pretty big chunk of money. So what I would recommend is actually doing a smaller match, which still will get you the 1 point on that project, you know, enough that it shows that you're serious and not just $1 or something, but $1,000 from the Friends, and as the correspondence in front of you shows, it would also be $1,000 from the town. So that would still get you half the points for the bonus without committing, you know, $10,000+. And I don't believe that would have a major impact on the grant scoring. Because it's this kind of arcane grant stuff, but it's you have two projects that are scored. You're going to get the maximum match for the other one.
Are we going
It'll
to
average
know,
out.
Are we
going to
know about the senior center before the town meeting in June? Because the $1,000 is for the fiscal 18 budget that we.
No, and that could be done contingent upon award of the grant. You most likely won't know until July about the award of the grant, unfortunately.
So if we do sign this, Karen, you can't lose sight of the fact that we have to add that as an article. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Haven Ave resident, regarding the drainage thing on Haven Ave, it's affecting not only our property, but there's three properties for sale, abandoned, foreclosed on, whatever, on the adjoining street. Mm-hmm. Someone came by and asked me about the property, and he says, is it always this wet? He was trying to buy it. And he said, the town just said, that, well, there's a river that runs through there, we can't do anything about it. But our property is all wet on the side and way in the back, and theirs, I guess they can't sell it, the house can't be sold because of wetness, because I guess originally it was not designed correctly. So that's all I'd say. It is okay. Important to do that because it's bladed property beside us now at this point.
Yeah.
advocate.
Yep. Thank you.
Dave, did you have your hand up?
Yeah, can you touch on the, did you talk about a gas station? Are you talking about the Phoenix property?
Excuse me?
Okay, can you want to explain to everyone, because you know that's private property, and if it gets cleaned up, what's going to happen to it after, and
sure.
Why should the town get involved, and I mean, explain the whole thing.
Sure, I'm not sure that I have all of the backstory, but okay. From my understanding is that, it's 15 Post Road. The property owner has granted access in the past for the town's agent or consultant to come out and do environmental sampling. This is a former gas station that had a leak of gasoline. I think it was in 1998. It got into the soil and the groundwater, and the state came out and cleaned up the bulk of the contaminants, but not everything. And over the years, CMRPC has worked with the town under a previous grant from the US EPA to do some sampling that showed that there's no imminent hazard, but there still are some contaminants in the soil, in the groundwater. And nothing's happened since 1998. It's been vacant, or essentially vacant, since I believe 2000. Given that it's not moving forward and that the property owner doesn't have the resources to continue with the assessment and cleanup, and has been so certified by the state of Massachusetts that they don't have the resources to do this, the advisory committee instructed me to look at trying to find grant funding to at least get a full and complete understanding of what's in the ground, so that going forward, whomever it is, the property owner, a new property owner, would have enough information to go into the cleanup phase so that the property can get rezoned.
Okay, but I thought we were discussing town property and town roads, and now you're stepping into a private property.
Sure, and again, that's only by permission of the property owner. There's no one's going to be going onto a property without their say. It's eligible under this program.
What he's getting at is, why is taxpayers' dollars going into private property cleanup?
Well, the property owner apparently does not have the resources to do this. So you have a blighted property that's been underutilized or vacant for approaching 20 years. Their arrears and taxes, I believe. Getting the site cleaned up and back in productive use is in the town's benefit in the long term.
I believe they're still renting it, and I believe they're still paying the water bill.
So okay.
That there's an issue there as well. But yep. Getting it back on the tax rolls is what I would like to do.
Yep.
If you remember correctly, they wanted to donate the land years ago, and we were advised by town council not to, because we'd be subject to all the liability involved.
Yeah, the town, in the State Brownfields Act, I used to work at the DEP, so I can talk to this a bit. The town has protections if its property is acquired in certain ways, but not through a gift or a purchase. So.
This allows us to get to the point where we understand the property so that we can make a decision.
Exactly, it gets you to a decision point.
This was the idea. One report said it was about a $40,000 expense, and one was like $300,000 to do this. They've now gone up and actually gotten a budgetary estimate that's in line with what it ought to be. So that my thought is, let's figure out what it's going to take to put it back on the property.
David, question. If we did get a grant and did get it cleaned up, does the town have to pay the grant back in order to sell the property?
No. There is a lien from DEP on the property for past work that they did 15 years ago. But under this program, there's no requirement that anything be paid back.
Why can't we take that grant money and put it somewhere else in town, other roads, rather than cleaning up a private property?
You could. These are the projects that I was instructed to look at for this year. But there's nothing to say that you couldn't do it elsewhere. I mean, partly it's, what projects were ready during the application window.
I'm just having a hard time. It's private property, and we're talking about our town roads and our town drains and all of the town, all over your own as a town, but you're stepping into a private property. I mean, if you're trying to get that back in the tax rolls, we could talk about 30 houses in this town that need to be put back on.
I think part of that goes back to the national objectives of the CDBG program, which is, again, to help benefit low to moderate income residents and to eliminate blight. So a lot of that happens on private property.
That property certainly qualifies as blight, and even if it's not an imminent risk, I don't think this town needs any more issues with its water supply than a lot of individual wells have already, but being formerly a manufacturing type environment here. So there's a lot of other contaminants in the environment. You don't need to leave that sitting there in the center of town.
Y'all set it?
Yeah, I guess no, sort of.
I'm on the fence with Dave as well. I disagree with Beth that if it's a water issue,
we got town water through there.
But nobody wants to touch that property. I physically tried to reach out to a developer who has access to get rid of dirty dirt, and he's kind of backed off from it. I think it should go to the private market, but nobody wants to touch it.
Yeah, and that's the intention here, is to get the property, if possible, to a point where someone wants to buy it and understands what the risks are.
We talk about new businesses in the town, you know, cleaning that up attracts businesses back to that corridor and can go back to Route 9 corridor for business friendly environment. So I guess I just talked myself off the fence. Any other comments? Yes, ma'am.
I'm just wondering, are there any, because of accepting this money from the federal government, are there any other quote unquote strings attached once you do that?
There are your standard federal boilerplate requirements that any grant funding from the state or rather from the federal government always has. You know, things like, you know, you can't go lobbying on federal issues as a town, things like that. There are various certifications that you have to commit to. If this grant were larger, you would have to commit to an additional auditing requirement. But it's not going to trigger that, so you know, it's. I can tell you, the town has had six of these grants in the past, and has been part of a number of other regional programs that were led by other communities. So I don't believe anything horrible has happened as a result of them. But
well, not necessarily horrible, but those limitations can keep you from doing other things sometimes, and that's what I would be worried about. Now we're going to be coupling with Sturbridge. In the area of, is it senior housing?
There are two components to that one. Again, that one's actually having a similar public hearing tonight at the Selectmen's meeting in Sturbridge. That one is, there's one component called the Housing Rehabilitation Loan Program. It's a deferred payment loan program, so folks who meet the income requirements, who are otherwise eligible, if they stay in their home for a 15-year period, they never have to repay the loan. The loans can be up to $35,000 in most cases to address code issues, as well as once the code issues are addressed, they can do all sorts of other things, you know, new windows, energy improvements, all sorts of improvements. It's a great program. I know that at least a couple of dozen homes in Brookfield have been assisted through that program in the last 10 or 15 years. The other piece of that application is a program that they're calling Aging in Place, which would be a relatively small grant program to eligible seniors for, I think it's up to $5,000 to make safety improvements to the home. So that's things like grab bars in the bathtub, you know, a lot of accessibility improvements in the home. So I can't speak directly to that application. Again, it's Sturbridge. It's being led by the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission on behalf of Sturbridge. But they have been in direct coordination with the advisory committee here, so there's been input from here.
Somebody did get a grant for, say, $25,000 for a septic system. They have to live in the present 15 years.
Yes. So
the past, is the heirs responsible for the payback?
So what happens is there is a lien for the value of the project placed on the property. If, say, halfway through the 15 years, the person moves out or what have you, they would be responsible for paying back the prorated portion of the project. So that is something that everyone who is looking at the program is made well aware of. I believe for people over a certain age, and again, this is not my project, it's part of the other application, but it is a shorter timeline for people over a certain age. But I can't speak directly to that, unfortunately. That's the Sturbridge application.
I guess I'd just like to sort of speak on behalf of the friends of the town hall that we see that the ADA transition plan being essential for the town as to apply for CDBG grants in the future. That needs to be done. So we endorse that, because that will support further grant funding for the town moving forward, and also that the senior center design funding also seems like an important step in cleaning up this building, so we support the full grant application as it is.
Anybody else? Dave?
What are our chances of getting this grant? Because I know in Draper and High School, you've applied for this a few times.
Yeah, I believe you're correct. It's been a couple of times. I think it's pretty strong. I'm always hesitant to say anything. It's a competitive program, and they've changed virtually all of the rules for the program this year. So we're in a whole new world. Again, the way that the program has been restructured, there is a bit of an advantage for Brookfield, because they tack on a need factor for each community, and Brookfield is considered not a high need community, but a moderately high need community by that measure. And so again, I think there is an advantage there, but we've never seen, they've never operated it this way before, so I can't say it's a 70% chance or a 50% chance, or I can't get into that level of detail.
Is Cindy still in the room?
Yes.
Cindy, is the town capable of completing the Hayden High project, Draper project, in-house?
I can't speak to the water portion of it. In previous years, yes, we would have been. I'm not sure what the new superintendent needs more to take on a project like that.
Any other questions? Comments, questions?
No, I think we should either get this done and just have town hall for a minute, if we can.
But that would alleviate him from being here anymore?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to entertain the proposed motion, and this allows the chair to sign these three documents in front of me that were mentioned, to support and approve the submission of a fiscal year 2017 CDBG application, including the activities as presented today, which with allowance for minor budget or program adjustments, and furthermore to authorize the chair and CFO to sign all documents required for the application.
So moved.
I will second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
What do I want to do? Is close the public hearing first?
Yeah, do we need to do those for him?
No, these have been kicking around for a while.
Yeah, if you want, you can put them in the mail. And there is a final cover sheet for the final application that will have to be signed as well. And I can, I'll correspond via Karen. Yeah. Thank you.
So I will entertain a motion to close the public hearing at 6:44. Do I have a motion? I will second. No discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
And Clarence piggybacking. Number three, by the way, is already done, so we can move on from that. So
piggybacking.
What a discussion for town hall.
So back to the furnace, and Bill's volunteering to assist us. We wanted to have a discussion on that topic.
Did you have any discussion? Ladies and gentlemen, if we can just take discussions outside, we're still in a meeting. Thank you. Did you want to come on up?
Sure.
Thank you. So you weren't here for our last meeting. Rumor had it you were sunning yourself. Congratulations.
Yes.
And excellent article, by the way, in the Boston Globe.
Thank you.
Congratulations as well. So we discussed renovation of the heating system.
Yep.
The floor is yours.
Just in conversation, I've heard that the second furnace is dead. Is that the main office space is still okay,
water,
but the
forced hot water off the first.
Yes, but the second furnace is done. We've had a meeting of the I guess there's two things. One, I'm willing to volunteer to support the gathering of proposals and working with them to make sure that they're aligned with all of the various planning documents to replace. You know, so I'd be willing to coordinate the gathering of the quotes to make sure they're all on the same page.
So is the proposed senior center renovation part of the plans that were submitted? Is that what's going to be going out to bid?
Yes. Yeah, so there's going to be design documents, and we have the general floor plan
to work with.
But that's what we're going to use is those documents for heat loss and air infiltration and all that for a bit.
The Austin study.
We don't have like a full heat
they loss. They would have to do that yet. Themselves. But you're going to give them a request for proposal.
Exactly. I could get something together that encompasses all of the planning documents that we have, so just so that if it's McDonald or whoever it is, they're all working off the same.
Well, that's what we need.
Information.
We were just throwing things at a wall and hoping they'd stick.
Exactly. So I'd be willing to gather that information, work with Karen, and just get those three quotes and.
And then part two of that was to see if there were any grants out there to pay for it.
Yes, I've asked. Actually, Andrew, I asked the question just because he's sort of a grant guy. He hasn't been able to find anything for like the furnace.
Nothing that is going to be useful in your timeline, and there's some programs out there if you have green community status or some other things, perhaps, but nothing that's going to be useful right now.
Yeah, so I wasn't able to find anything from Andrew, unfortunately. We did have a meeting with the Friends of the Town Hall, and they are willing to raise money in support of the furnace replacement.
But in the design, it might be a renovation of the whole building.
Well, I'm thinking the furnace replacement is kind of something that might need to happen sooner than later. Unless
it can happen over the summer for the next winter.
Yeah, but in terms of the scope of the design for the, I mean, if it ends up lining up with the design time frame.
Well, I personally don't want to do it twice.
Oh, exactly,
We have forced hot air over here, we have forced hot water over there. Yeah. If we can combine one system that's going to be efficient for the whole building, that's the route we really need to go, even if we have to gut everything.
Yeah, and the long-term plan is to replace the furnace as the basement is redone to redo the heating system.
But it all depends if we're going to do forced hot air or forced hot water, because stuff where plumbing.
Exactly. So to do a full evaluation, what I'm willing to do at first is anyway just the replace cost, you know, get that so that we can replace it in a way that we can have the building functional, but also I'll coordinate with the architect who's been looking at the basement design and see how that would incorporate in, if there's a way, if he recommends that we can just replace that for now, keep it going, or if he says, you know, hold off, the building's not working. I'll talk to these folks and just get a proposal together for you.
Because the ductwork is scary down there.
Well, it's ancient. Yeah, it has to go at some point, but, you know. So I'm willing to dig into that and do some research and get a proposal for you.
Well, that's what we need to start as a proposal, before the board, before we go out for proposals.
So I think that would be.
And make it consistent with the Austin Road.
But that's the plan. And Bill is a huge advocate for getting this whole building done, but that's where we need to bring it to the town. And if they vote it down, we're done.
Which, I mean, just in terms of replacing the furnace, or?
I want a system that's going to work for the whole building.
Yeah.
Renovated.
Okay.
Or if it can be systematically done through renovations. Because right now, that's a hodgepodge.
Oh, it is. So
just fixing that and tying it into what's there is not efficient.
It isn't, but I'm going to dig into it more.
We have a senior center now, we got to heat downstairs. Mm-hmm. So that's all new ductwork if it's all forced hot air.
Mm-hmm.
We have that whole section we have upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
A couple offices are on forced hot water. So all those have to be tied in.
Yeah. So, I don't know what the best way to move forward is right now, whether it's replace the furnace as is, just to get us through, because it'll be, even with the design stuff for the senior center, the best case would be the next grant cycle around. We're talking 3 to 5 years out.
We have estimates already to replace that.
Yeah.
Downstairs.
Do you have, how many estimates do you have? Because do you need three, or?
I think there were two.
Al Jones came
up with it. I think they were under our procurement, under the state procurement law.
The
larger
issue was that it was a hodgepodge.
Three different guys had three different scenarios.
Yeah. So I'll work on what I'll bring to the. I'll work with Karen, and we'll try to bring to the select board a proposal to replace, and then also some sort of. I'll try to talk to the architect and them to see how that would impact the long term.
The architect can weigh in, I think.
Yeah, and I'll get as much feedback from because we've got the Austin design. I can talk to him as well, and I can talk to Catlin, who's doing the senior center stuff, and pick both their brains and make sure that we're not going to hurt ourselves if we replace it, or if they recommend something different in the meanwhile. So I'm willing to do that if this board would want me to.
I wanted to charge Bill with one more thing. So I went on.
What about sleep? Is he able to sleep?
Yeah, he's able to sleep. He takes off on the door and so on. But in doing the research for Mass Historical, starting around, I attended the meeting for the next grant round for their stuff. And I met Christopher Noonan from Preservation Incorporated. They do rehabs of buildings like this for seniors, senior housing, that's and so I reached out to him and said, what if? And in asking what if, could this building be rehabbed to senior housing? An interesting thing that you learned.
The entire building?
Yeah. Okay. Take the whole building.
Anything could be rehabbed to anything.
Can. So, but now it's a performer. Does anybody make money on the deal? And going to him, again, this is all approval. It's not anybody putting a pencil to paper or whatnot. From his experience, what he's concerned about, because the second floor is the way it is, it would, what he's suggesting is, what you'd want to do is to split the second floor so that it's like floor A and B kind of thing, to be able to get the most numbers of units in the building. And given that, one, if you were to do that, you take away the historical benefits so that the grants or any other remediation that they might see from doing something like that would then fall away because of the historic nature of the buildings. And so he would be really concerned about whether it would make sense at all to do that sort of thing. As a potential reuse application, he would suggest that the performer wouldn't work out. So what I would like to do is give Bill a copy of what he gave me as a starting point, as he's working with Austin to say, Austin, from what you know, is something like this practical? But I think the answer is going to come back is it's not practical.
Well, that's way down the road. You can obviously give it to him. I don't think any of us want to see that happen.
But at least we know that, or we'll have.
Does something like that kind of an application make sense? And what he's telling me, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah, so, and we've kind of voted on that at town meeting, but we want to have as much. I can look into it and run that by everybody, too.
While he's working with Austin, it's a question.
Yeah. So, on the other side of that, with the furnace, if we come up with a plan that the selectmen agree to, the Friends of the Town Hall are willing to raise money to support that. Whether it be 5 to 10,000 or something, we don't know what the estimate is going to be or what's going to the cost is going to be. But the Friends are there to support it.
That'll help on the sale on the town floor.
So I just wanted to also put out that the Friends are willing to support the project. We want to keep the building working. So if it means replacing it to get us through the next 4 or 5 years, then so be it. But if it's something else, then we'll see what that is when we get to it. So. So that's all I have.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Item number 4. There was an open meeting law complaint filed by Mr. Martell in regards to his meeting. Filed it on January 10th. Forgive me if I'm not able to read it. It's in his handwriting. I was the subject of an executive session meeting for a specific stated reason. I chose to have the issue discussed in open session. During the discussion of the stated reason, Mrs. Lincoln detailed an additional complaint that I had not been notified of. His desire for the action is the board shall acknowledge that this did take place and work to ensure that it does not happen in the future. We do have to respond. Town Council has rendered an opinion. The highlights. I'd like to make a motion. If we agree with their response, if we can adopt and respond, and authorize Michelle Randazzo to respond on the behalf of the board.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second for discussion.
But basically, we're taking this under advisement.
This isn't an advisement. This is what she would send off to the ethics.
But the essence of the document is basically we're taking it under advisement.
The last paragraph, it's highlighted in your copy. Because there is no requirement under the open meeting law that any individual be given advance notice on specific topics to be discussed in executive session pursuant to purpose number 1, there is no open meeting law violation in this instance. So we're denying the violation, and it's laid out in this letter. So this vote is to send this opinion, which is just laid out.
Okay.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Item number 5, is it really that time already, Karen? Set meeting dates. So is this the last month that we've set?
Yeah.
So we're nothing set for...
At 10 to 2 seconds, we'll be set.
Conflict on the 7th, but I won't know until next week. Are you opposed if I do have a conflict to change?
No.
The only issue is that poll hearing again.
Yeah.
All right, so the 7th, March 7/21, April 4, 18. And we should hold off on that because of the election. Okay with that?
Yeah, we'll just get on with that.
Alright, so I'll entertain a motion if you want to set the next meeting dates for March 7th and 21st, April 4th and 18th.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Number 6, Municipid has closed. Two bidders, high bidders for the 77 MAC and the 80 MAC went to two different people. I'll entertain a motion to award the 1977 MAC for $3,100 to Chris Hicks, the 1980 MAC parts truck with spare motor and transmission for $2,750 to Scott Alcock.
So moved.
I'll second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Item 7, we have a veteran that's applying for a veteran's workout program. I will entertain a motion to approve Leonard S. Farr.
Yes. Motion to make
me. I'll second. Any discussion? Hearing none.
And he's got great computer skills as well.
Is that the gentleman you mentioned last week?
Yeah.
Beautiful. All in favor?
Aye.
Item number 8, wage authorizations, entertain a motion to approve Mr. Booz. That's his department. Mr. Help me, Marshallot? Did I pronounce it correctly? Ronald Marshall? Marshall Saul? I apologize, sir. Second operator for the water department at a rate of $20.04, approved by the personnel board.
Make the motion.
I'll second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Entertain a motion for Ms. Plum. It's a tax work-off position. Clerk at a rate of $11 per hour.
Make the motion.
I will second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Entertain a motion for Ms. Lazilli. Clerk, tax work-off position, rate of $11 an hour.
Make the motion.
Second, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
And for Mr. Farr, handyman, etc., tax work-off position for $11 an hour.
Make the motion.
Second, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Number 9, Cemetery Deed. Wow, that's scary.
As long as it's not mine, we're okay.
Maybe I should buy one so I can sign my own. Is that narcissistic? Is that an ethics violation?
I don't know about that, but not a good idea.
I will entertain a motion to approve Mr. Milner.
Make the motion.
For Lot 67, Section B. I will second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
It's always morbid, especially with people that you know. We're going to pass over number 10.
down the emails. Yep. We haven't completed that task yet. Because we have to the 85.
We have to pay for each email in town. It's come to the board's attention that there is, excuse me, a license plate out there floating around. The only way that it came, are you familiar with this?
A little bit.
The only way it came to our attention is that MassDOT through EasyPass is billing the town, catching the plate on camera. It was registered, I believe, to a 71 water pump truck with a fire department. Plates were canceled about 8 years ago, I believe. It was bidded out, it was sold. The chief had stated that they do not have to turn in plates, which they don't, they just have to cancel them. He stated they were canceled, they're not canceled, they're still registered to the town of Brookfield, that's how it came back to us. We've been in touch with Mr. Joseph. He's recommending that we basically claim that the plates are stolen and we have to cancel them. I would say again, but they were never canceled. So it's kind of an ongoing event that we're still working on. So just to bring you to that attention. There's sexual harassment documents in here. Is that your doing? Or?
Yes. So I reached out to the library, schools, yeah, for what their policy is, and that's for your benefit.
So we, when Jen was here, Jen wanted to do that. She brought that fact up. We went through the board. Michelle Randazzo recommended that we don't implement that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So just for your benefit, that is out there.
I agree, but I wanted to make sure that the document, the second learning in that process of asking for the procedure,
okay,
is they actually do three readings, and in doing the three readings, that's how they get the employees up to date as far as, or up to speed as far as the documentation, and to make sure that the people are gonna understand it and will follow it. And so, which bridges into the employee meeting next Tuesday, where we will, in fact, take the document and work our way through it. My goal in doing that is that the acknowledgments begin to be signed and available.
Just understand that it was under the advisement of Michelle not to do that, so obviously she's going to do the final draft, so.
Well, then we need to pull that document if that's...
I did ask Karen, did you find any of that documentation today? The correspondence of, I don't know if it was Michelle or Pat that advised last time. I thought it was Michelle. I talked to Michelle about it.
Okay.
Well, 100%, and Jen was upset about it. It was a harassment and sexual.
Oh, no, okay, we're talking two separate.
Well, it's
okay, as far as the harassment, the
they tied into each other.
A policy that the town implemented.
Which is the same thing that you're requesting, is that putting it in a handbook is implementing a policy.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And so I'm
so my only recommendation is to, and obviously it's going to be all vetted through Michelle before the final.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah,
so we're working on an employee handbook. One of the learnings that I've come to learn is that the school's got something we don't, town doesn't necessarily, and I'm asking that we consider it. And again, certainly the process, and again, Linda's not here tonight because it's really her project as far as the employee handbook. But where I'm sitting today, with what I've learned, that I would argue is that we should. So that's that topic. Now that we went down that road, I've lost track of the other thought that I had. Tuesday, that's what it was. So on Tuesday, are you talking about the acknowledgement? I'm confused. Just a moment ago.
I'm not confused. What do you
mean? Okay, so let's talk policies, the policy document. What we have is the first attachment in the policy document.
No, what I was talking about was years ago, Jen had brought forward harassment and whatnot.
Okay,
all right. And it was recommended that we didn't implement it.
Two subjects. Okay. I think I'm smarter.
Nothing to do with the financial policy.
Right. And I'm not talking financial at the moment.
Okay.
We'll talk.
Nor tonight. We're done talking about financial policy tonight, right?
Just 30 seconds.
Love you too.
All right. So on the employee handbook, we're in process to get that to town meeting for annual town meeting. And so I'm suggesting, as it goes, that new learning, they have a policy. Yes, I understand the back story, but my concern is that we ought to move forward with it. So as we debate this thing over the next couple months, that we kind of decide what the
proper thing is.
I'm not opposed to telling town employees that they can't sexually harass people. It's kind of a given.
Okay, so now let's talk policies for a moment. I was confused when we were talking. As far as the acknowledgement, my strategy in having a meeting on Tuesday is that we're going to go through the policy, understand that we have it, and acknowledge that we have it, so that that document would be signed by the department that's leaving that meeting.
Okay.
That's my point.
It should have been signed a couple of years ago.
That's also true.
Yeah. But the fact is, they all knew it was in place.
Well, again, several emails, and notes I didn't see.
And I'm not opposed to as many signatures as we can get. Yes. Makes them liable.
No, well, and what I would propose is that it's almost like a notebook. The first section of it is the actual policy that was signed in June of 2015. We then take that and get the acknowledge, well, you get the attachments, because there's some confusion about some attachments. We get the attachments, so it's clear that these are the current attachments. And then we then follow up with some language as far as the...
Now, the attachments are just the documents that we use to process paperwork.
Exactly.
And we have those in place.
The forms, like one of the turnover ones.
We at least found one today that we have
conflicting... had a new one, yeah.
That we have conflicting documents. So that's why we're...
And we charged Krista to put all those into Excel.
I know that.
And we're going to backtrack through that to make sure that we're all clear. So that's
the more than 30 seconds.
But that's my 30 seconds.
Anything else?
No, I think not.
I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make that motion.
I will second. No discussion, no favor.
Aye.
Thank you, everyone.